Really excited to be together. We're going to turn our attention now to God's Word. So get a copy of God's Word, of your Bible, whether that's paper. There's book Bibles all around underneath some of the chairs in front of you. You can do that on your phone. And if you don't have a Bible, that's totally fine. We're going to have the scriptures up on the screen behind me as we walk through this. And the reason we do this, we joke around that we're Harvest Bible Chapel. Bible's our middle name. But we believe that God has written a book, and that book is a love letter to us, and it tells us how we are to live in this broken, messy world in a way that loves Him in increasing ways and seeks to obey Him. And so we're going to do that now. As you saw from the little bumper video, we're in a series. This is the last week of that, where we're walking through parables of the kingdom, parables that Jesus tells about the kingdom of God. And so we're going to be in Matthew 13. You can go ahead and flip over and turn to that if you like at this point. I hope you're having a great beginning to the spring. The spring is like an interesting time for our family. We have like all of these birthdays like back to back, so it's like, you know, kind of hurtful to our budget in a little ways. You know what I'm talking about? When you're like, oh, we're buying more birthday presents for somebody else. That it's just like they're all right after, one after another. And maybe you as a kid, you had that one thing that you really wanted for your birthday. Or maybe you were like so many kids where you had that one thing that was like too big of a present, and so you like saved all of your money. Birthday came, you're like, I just want cash because I'm saving for that one thing. Do you have something like that? You remember as you were a kid, you have that thing, maybe it was a bike or something. For me, this is gonna date my age just a little bit. It was the original Nintendo's Legend of Zelda. The little cartridge, the game cartridge was gold. Any of you remember that? Some of you are far too young for that. But that was like the thing. And me and my brother, it felt like for years, we were like saving every penny. You know, you get like you go to your next door neighbors and like, will you pay me $5 to rake your leaves? You know, all of those kind of things. You save all of your birthday money. Every time you go to the store, you see the toys that you want as a kid and you're like, no. Because I want that game or that skateboard or whatever that thing was. I remember hoping that my younger brother would lose a tooth so that we would get like one more dollar to go towards our Legend of Zelda game. And finally, after all of that work, all of that saving, all of those times saying no to something else so that we could get that game that we loved, we finally had enough money. And I think we went to Walmart or Target, I don't remember, but we went there and we purchased that game, and all of it was worth it. We gladly shelled over every single dollar that we had so that we could get that perfect treasure, that gold cartridge that we so desperately wanted. Well, our passage today, Matthew 13, 44 through 46, is about a valued treasure. It's about something that we will give everything for. We will say no to all these other things so that we can get that one valuable treasure. It's the last of our parables that we're studying in our Parables of the Kingdom series, where Jesus is telling all of these stories with a spiritual point about what is the kingdom of God? What exactly is this? And he's telling us today through these parables that the kingdom of God is so valuable that it's worth giving up all else for. All of my savings, all of the things that I have in this life, I'll give it all up for the value of the kingdom of God. Let's take a moment and pray before we look at the text. Father, we're grateful for, again, this chance to gather. We're grateful for your word that you've given us, your perfect word that instructs us. God, we would pray that you would open our eyes to what you would have us to learn from your message, your word today. Do your work in us for our good and for your glory, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So as we walk through this passage, Matthew 13, 44 through 46, it's just a couple of verses. And what I want to do, I want to look at the two parables that are here. And then secondly, I want to ask one important question. And then finally, look at two challenges for us. First, let's look at the two parables. Jesus says, beginning in verse 44, he says, "The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. So again, Jesus talking about the kingdom of heaven. It's a kingdom, as we've been learning, that's completely unexpected. It's very different than what the people of God would have looked for. They had been waiting for the kingdom to come for hundreds and hundreds of years. It was promised to God's people that the kingdom of God would come, that there would be a king, there would be a Messiah, there would be somebody who would provide a way and would conquer. And finally, this Messiah, this king, arrived. But the kingdom and the king looked very different than what they thought it would look like, from what all they were waiting for. They expected the king to ride in on a horse and to conquer all of their enemies, and instead he rode in on a donkey and said to love your enemies. They were expecting that he would take his rightful throne, the king. But as we learned on Good Friday, his throne was a cross. It didn't look the way that they thought. This was the coming of the kingdom of heaven as Jesus came and ushered it all in. The kingdom is now here, and there will be a day when this king will ride in on a white horse, when this king will take his rightful throne and sit upon it. But until that day, this kingdom continues to unfold in somewhat unexpected ways to us. It unfolds here on earth through us, through its citizens of the kingdom. Those of us who have turned from our sins and have trusted Jesus Christ by faith. If you've come to the place where you have come to the rightful king, even though it looks very differently than you thought, and you've come to that king and you have bowed your knees in submission to that king, then you're part of his coming kingdom that is already here and is continuing to unfold. That's what Jesus is talking about as he talks about the kingdom of heaven. And he tells these parables, they're short stories that a person would tell with a spiritual point. It's not so much about what this guy found in the field, it's far more about what did Jesus mean by it. And he's describing, notice he says, the kingdom of heaven is like, and he says it's like treasure that's hidden in a field. This was really common for them. There weren't like all of these big banks. There wasn't a stock market for you to put all of your funds in. There weren't like a 401ks or things like that. They didn't have any of that. It was actually very common for them to actually bury their savings in the ground. They would find a place on their property, you know, maybe make a little treasure map with an X on it and like 30 paces this way and 10 paces that way. And they would find a place and they would bury their nest egg, their savings in it. And lots of times things would happen for people. Maybe they would go off to war and they would die without unearthing their nest egg. Maybe a person would die from a sickness without telling somebody where it was. And it was actually fairly common in that day for there to be buried treasure around, which sounds like exciting for people who watch pirate movies or something. You know, oh, there's this treasure out there. We've joked around. This building was built in the 1860s. It was owned for about 100 years by the Masons, and we've joked around that there's Mason treasure somewhere. We've looked all over. We've sent our students up in the rafters and all sorts of stuff. Well, no treasure as far as we can tell. That would be great. But here, that's what people did, is they buried their nest egg, their savings, in the ground. Oftentimes, it would be forgotten. And so here, this servant, this man, finds this treasure and then covers it back up, buries it again so that it stays hidden. The word for field that's used here is it signifies something that's like way out in the country. It typically would be a kind of field that maybe it was used for farming or used where animals would graze. It's like that type of word for a field. So it's possible that this was a servant of a landowner that's out working the field, and then he finds this treasure. We're not totally sure, and the laws of that day aren't actually super clear to us. The treasure may have actually belonged to the person who found it, regardless of the land, or it may have belonged to the landowner. We're not really sure. It would be one of those kind of gray areas, but to prevent some kind of legal battle, the guy has this plan. I'm going to bury it again, and I'm going to buy this whole field so that it can be mine. Now, Jesus isn't making a judgment necessarily about the ethics of this person's decision. He's not saying you should go do this and try to twist around. He's making a spiritual point, and his point is give everything for that treasure. That's what he's trying to say here. So picture this servant out in the field tilling the ground and suddenly hits something hard. Boom. What is that? And unearths the thing, looks around, finds this treasure, maybe opens up the box, you know, just like the movies, and all the treasure like glows on his face. Oh, you know? So like he finds this incredible treasure, shuts the door, and he's like, did anybody see that? And he has this great plan. Now, I'm going to bury it again, and then I'm going to buy all of that. Notice in this parable, though, the treasure was found when he wasn't looking for it. He sort of stumbled across it suddenly. He wasn't looking for it. And isn't that how it happens so often with so many of us when we come to Jesus Christ? I didn't really know that I needed. I was sort of going about my life. I thought everything was fine. Everything seemed to be going okay. I mean, I had issues, but yeah, it was all right, you know. And then suddenly I hit something hard. Suddenly, in a moment, everything changed for me. And notice his response. It says that in his joy, he sells all that he had. Think about if you're this man, this servant for a moment, and you find this incredible treasure, what would your attitude be as you were going about selling all that you had so that you could gain this immeasurably wealthy treasure? It would be joy. Now, your friends would think it was really weird when you started selling all your stuff on Instagram. You know, like your friend who you're like, oh yeah, they're moving, and you keep clicking through and you're like, wow, they're selling a lot of things. Have they gone crazy? They'd be like, what exactly is happening? But your response would be joy. This treasure that I'm, all of the things that I'm giving up, this treasure is worth so much more than all of it, and I'm doing it with great joy. You're giving it all up joyfully because of the incredible value of what you're going to gain from it. It's not like a begrudging thing. It's not like, man, I got to get rid of everything. It's, I'll gladly get rid of all of it for the incredible treasure that's there waiting for me. You know, one of the things that I get to do as a pastor that's like one of my favorite things to do is I get to officiate weddings. I get the best seat in the house. The best part of the whole wedding just is when I get to stand here and the groom is standing here and those doors open and the bride comes through. I'll let you in on a little secret. I never look at the bride when those doors open. What do? I look at the groom looking at the bride and the way that his face lights up when she walks through those doors. That's the best part of the whole day, is seeing that for me. I love to get to see that joy on his face because of what's happening right there and the incredible treasure. And you know, for that to happen, there has to be some sort of proposal. Everybody has a different story of how the proposal happened, but when that man gets down on one knee and offers a ring and she says yes, it's a no to everything else. It's a turning away from all. I'll gladly give up any other relationship because of what we can have together, because of the incredible value that's there before me. It's not coerced. It's not forced. You've never seen a proposal where it's like, well, yeah, but, I mean, I kind of want to, it doesn't happen like that. It's, yes, I'm all in. There's so much joy because there's so much greater value waiting in the thing that I'm looking for, in the treasure that's there. The Apostle Paul had this very same attitude about his relationship with Jesus Christ. He was one who was an enemy of Jesus, persecuting the Christians, throwing them in prison and having them beaten and even murdered because they followed Jesus. And then he's walking on the road to Damascus to go kill more Christians. That's where he's headed. And bam, he hits something hard. And his life is forever changed because he meets Jesus Christ. He wasn't looking for it at all, but he hit something hard that day, and he met Jesus. Later, Paul would say in Philippians 3, whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. It's worth more to me than everything else. For his sake, I've suffered the loss of all things, and I count all of those things as rubbish. They're just garbage to me because of what I can receive, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, not because of all the things that I sort of try to do correctly, but that which comes, the righteousness that comes through faith in Christ. The righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by all means possible I may attain the resurrection of the dead. So all these things that I just thought were so important to me, so valuable, so critical to my happiness and my well-being, they pale in comparison to knowing Jesus Christ, my risen Savior. And when you hit that treasure in that field, all of the rest of life just doesn't seem to matter. It pales in comparison to knowing Jesus Christ. Jesus then tells a second parable here back in Matthew 13, continuing in verse 45. His second parable he tells us is, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who on finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought that pearl. This merchant traveled all over to buy and to sell different jewels. He's in search of fine pearls. He's looking for it. It would have been one of the most expensive jewels that they had in that day, and a great pearl find like this could be worth the equivalent of millions of dollars. He finds this one of great value, and his response is the same as the man in the field. He sells all that he has to get the pearl of great value, but notice the difference here. The man in the field wasn't looking. He was just kind of going about his life and then hits something difficult. But this merchant is searching. He's looking for this very thing, something of greater value than all else that he has. Like, he knew it was out there somewhere, and he found it when he was searching. Some of you have been searching for meaning in this life. I know that there's something more than what I'm experiencing. It can't just be like this. It can't just be amassing wealth or having fun or all of these things that we search after so often. Filling your time in your life with so many things and looking for satisfaction and value in money and in pleasure and in status and power and security and love and belonging and all of those things that we often look for. This pearl of great value is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's yours if you would just turn away from all of those things and seek only that. That's what Jesus is telling us here. This pearl of great value, this treasure that's found in a field, is worth all else to us. Now, I want to be very, very clear, because some people are super sensitive about this as it relates to a church. I don't think that Jesus is telling us here that every person needs to sell everything you have, give all of your money to the church, and then you'll be saved. I don't think that that's what Jesus is saying here. Even throughout the Gospels, the people that Jesus meets, there are a few people that Jesus says, sell everything you have, give it to the poor, and come follow me. But that really only happens a couple of times. I don't think he's actually telling us to necessarily empty our bank account, but I do think he is saying, the treasure, the pearl of great price, the gospel of Jesus Christ, your relationship with a risen Savior who forgives you of your sins and calls you to follow him and to bow your knee in submission to him, that better be more valuable to you than everything else. And if the Lord would come to you and say, give it all up, you better do it right away. That's what he's saying. I don't think that he's going to tell everybody. I don't think he's going to tell most people, give away everything you have. But I think he's going to say, in your heart, do you value me over all else, above anything else? There can be nothing else in your life that competes for allegiance with the King. It is only him, and all of my life is in submission to that King. He tells every person who would follow him to abandon everything that would get in the way of complete and total allegiance to that King. Because the kingdom of heaven, it's worth everything that you have. It's worth it all. And once you discover that kingdom, once you discover that relationship with Jesus Christ for what it really is, no amount of sacrifice is unreasonable. Nothing that you give up will make you sad. I'll give it all up for this incredible value. I just want to give you a couple of questions to think about. I'm not going to answer them for you, but if you're thinking, how do I really tell if Jesus is worth all of it to me? Like, he hasn't told me to give all of my money away and to follow him, so how do I really know? Here's some questions that you can ask yourself. How do I spend my time? How do I spend my financial resources? How do I go about making important decisions in my life? What are the things that I consider? Do I just think about what I want, or do I think about what would be honoring to the King? When I'm squeezed in those difficult times in my life, what comes out? What's my response? In the midst of suffering, where do I turn? Where do I look? Only if Jesus is all for you can you really enter the kingdom of heaven. Only if he is the treasure alone, only if he alone is the pearl of great price will you receive the kingdom. So that's two parables. Now one question. What makes the kingdom so valuable? What exactly is it? I mean, we can think about a pearl. It's a large pearl, and it's rare, and so it's for sure costly. We can think of a big, you know, treasure chest of the glowing gold coins and think, well, clearly that's valuable. So what exactly makes the kingdom so valuable? If I really trade everything, if I turn away from all of the things of this world, all the things that I believe are important, then what do I get out of it? What's the value to me? In the kingdom of heaven, just a couple of things that I've written down. In the kingdom of heaven, there's forgiveness. That you and I are sinners in need of a Savior. That this world is a broken place, and you are a broken person, and so am I. And it's not by any righteousness of my own. We just read Paul saying that very thing. It's not because of what I've done. It's not because I'm a good person. It's not because I do good things. It's not because of my background. It's not because of all of those things that I've done in my life. I am a sinful, broken person. The people who regularly come to church here know that I call myself a big bag of sin all the time. That's who we are apart from Jesus Christ. We're broken, in need of a Savior, and there is a Savior, and his name is Jesus Christ. You have broken your relationship with God. There's a rift, there's a gap there, and you can't cross that. No amount of you trying to be good and trying to do the right thing and say the right thing and go to the right place on Sunday, no amount of that will ever save you. It won't. There's only one thing that will save you, and it's Jesus' death on the cross. That's why he went to the cross on Good Friday, because a payment was required. And he paid for your sins and for mine on the cross with his own blood. That's why he died there, so that you could be forgiven, so that you could be made right before a holy God. We remember Jesus' death on the cross in our place. It should have been you on that cross, bleeding and bloodied and striving for air. Likely Jesus suffocated is how he finally died on the cross. That should have been you, and it should have been me, but Jesus died on that cross in your place. And he rose on Easter Sunday to prove that he's God, to prove that he conquers sin and death, and he will set you free. And so if you turn from your sins, turn from all that this world has to offer, and bow your knee, trust and believe on Jesus Christ, you will be saved. To believe on the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved. Lord, I've tried on my own, and I'm a mess, and I'm a sinful person in need of a Savior, and I'm believing that your death on the cross is a payment for my sin. And I'm bowing my knee to you and submitting to you. It's repentance and surrender to the King. And because of that forgiveness that you receive, only when you turn away from those things and accept the incredible treasure that's there before you, that you receive forgiveness, and because of the forgiveness, then we have hope, hope for all of eternity. Paul would say again in Ephesians 2:4, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, in our sins, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you've been saved, not because of anything that you did, but because of his incredible mercy, you've been saved and raised up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. There is hope waiting for you for all eternity, spending it in heaven with a perfect God, who's put your sin to death and raised you to new life. This is what we do in baptism. This is why we practice baptism. We call it by immersion. It means you go under the water. Because there's nothing special about the water. We don't bless it or do anything like that. It comes from a hose back here. Elvin fills the tank for us, our head deacon, and he warms the water so it's not freezing when we get in. That's it. It's basically a big bathtub, but it's a symbol in the going under the water. It's a picture of dying with Jesus Christ, that he has died for my sins, and I'm trusting that death for me, and then raised to new life. In the same way that Jesus died on Friday and was raised to new life on Sunday, so we too, when we come to that place where we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, we die to our sins and are raised to new life in Christ, and we have incredible hope. Jesus rose from the dead so that we are people of hope, so that we can have hope in his resurrection and all that's coming. Paul would say again in Romans 8:18 and following, I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy, are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. There's still great suffering in this world. Following Jesus doesn't mean all of that goes away. It just puts it in perspective as we have hope for the glory that's coming. For the creation awaits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption, from all of the sin that we see, and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. Not only the whole creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit. We groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for the adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. Paul gives us the picture of a woman in labor, the incredible pains that she goes through, but she has hope that there's a child coming on the other side. And because of the resurrection, there is a glorious future awaiting you and I if we've come to know Jesus Christ. All of this is because of his incredible love and mercy for you. So finally, two challenges. For the one who's not yet a believer, still on the sidelines, still not sure what you think about this whole Jesus thing. I mean, I came to church and it's kind of what we do on Easter, but I haven't bowed my knee. I haven't submitted to Jesus Christ. I haven't turned from all of my sin and trusted Jesus Christ by faith. Can you see how valuable this treasure is? It gives us glorious forgiveness and hope and genuine, enduring, gracious love when we're so undeserving of it. Why wouldn't you want that treasure of great value? It could cost a lot. You have to renounce all other allegiances. It has to be Jesus and only Jesus. But what do you gain? What do you get from it? Look at the incredible riches of forgiveness and hope and love. Jesus says in another place, Luke 9, 23 and following, he says, and he said to all of them, if anyone would come after me, let them deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. For whoever would save his life would lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. Whoever's giving it up, they will save it. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses or forfeits himself? For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words, of him, the Son of Man, of Jesus, will be ashamed when he comes into his glory and the glory of the Father and his holy angels. But I tell you truly, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the kingdom of God. The kingdom is here, and it's of so much value. So turn from all that the world has to offer. Turn from your sins that so easily entangle us. Leave it all behind and receive the free gift of the gospel of forgiveness that's found in Jesus Christ, of the incredible hope that we have and the love that he's given us. And if you are a believer, if you've come to that place where you have turned from your sins, you have bowed the knee to Jesus Christ, you have trusted him by faith. Even some who have found the treasure and found the pearl, some of us have held on to some of those things of the world, some of those things that we have, unwilling to release them to the Lord, unwilling to say, Jesus, you're worth more than all of that. Desiring to take hold of the kingdom, but unwilling to let go of this fleeting world, and we have one foot on either side of the kingdom. Listen, Jesus tells us here in Luke 9, only a full denial of self, only a complete rejection of myself and of all other allegiances, only in that will we truly become members of the King's kingdom. So stop with the half-heartedness. Stop with the weak and hesitating and the double-minded Christianity, the lack of commitment, but put all of your eggs in one basket, the kingdom of heaven, because you found incredible treasure in Jesus Christ. So give everything you have for it, because it's worth it all. It's worth more than you could ever imagine. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for your incredible gift of salvation that's found in Jesus Christ. We truly are undeserving of the mercy and the grace that you've showered upon us. We are thankful for your love and your forgiveness that's shown to us in Jesus Christ. Thank you so much for the gift of Jesus on the cross in our place, dying the death that we deserved so that we could live the life that you've set before us. God, thank you for the hope and for the love that we have that's found in you. Thank you for what you're doing here. We would pray that you would continue to stir our hearts to leave all other allegiances and follow you alone, because you're worth it all. We pray in Jesus' name.